And here we are. So welcome, everyone. Without further ado, I hand over to our chair, Professor Sarah Leonard.
Thank you very much, Christian. So good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this event organized in the framework of the EU CITER Jean Monnet Network on EU Counterterrorism, for which we gratefully acknowledge the support of the Erasmus Plus program of the European Union. So today we have a really interesting event with a book launch. So this is the most recent book co-authored by Dr. Ori Wertman and Professor Christian Kaunert. So the format of the event will be as follows. So Ori and Christian will introduce their book for about 25 to 30 minutes, so perhaps a little bit less or a little bit more. We will see how much they want to unveil at this point. And the presentation will then be followed by remarks and comments from our three distinguished discussants. So we are very happy to have with us today Professor Kobi Michael, Professor Thierry Balzac, and Dr. Rita Floyd, who we all comment on the book and perhaps on securitization more broadly. So as all our speakers are very distinguished and have extensively published, I could spend a long time introducing them, so I will just focus on some highlights, but there would be far more to say. So starting with the two authors of the book. So first, Dr. Ori Wertman is a researcher at the Institute for National Security Studies, the INSS, and coordinator of strategic assessment. He's also a research fellow at the University of South Wales. And in the past, Dr. Wertman has served as Itzhak Herzog's foreign affairs and political advisor. His areas of research are national security, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, counterterrorism, and Israeli politics. And he has widely published not only in the academic literature, but also in the media in Israel and abroad. Professor Christian Kaunert, who's also the director of the EU CITER Jean Monnet Network, is chair of policing and security, as well as director of the International Centre for Policing and Security at the University of South Wales, as well as professor of international security at Dublin City University. And he is currently also the editor of the Journal of Contemporary European Studies, and he has extensively written on international security, in particular the role of the European Union in international security cooperation. And now with regard to our three discussants, so Professor Kobi Michael is a senior researcher at the INSS and editor-in-chief of strategic assessment. He's also a visiting professor at the International Centre for Policing and Security at the University of South Wales. His main research interests are conflict resolution, strategy, national security, civil-military relations, failed states, peacekeeping, state-building operations, and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And Professor Michael served as the Deputy Director General and head of the Palestinian desk at the Ministry for Strategic Affairs. On to Professor Thierry Balzac. Professor Balzac is Professor of Political Science at Sciences Po and professorial fellow at Séries Sciences Po in Paris. He is the director of graduate studies for international relations at the School of Research at the same university. He was formerly the scientific director at the French Ministry of Defense, where he contributed to the development of a multi-million euro program to support the study of security in France. And Professor Balzac has extensively written on securitization theory, but also on other matters such as grant strategy. And Dr. Rita Floyd, has been in Birmingham since April 2012, when she was appointed Birmingham Fellow in Conflict and Security. Before then, she was a British Academy Postdoctoral Fellow at the University of Warwick, and before then an ESRC Postdoctoral Fellow. She's now an Associate Professor. And she has extensively published on securitization as well. Actually, two books with Cambridge University Press, Security and the Environment, Securitization Theory and US Environmental Security Policy, followed by another book with Cambridge University Press on the morality of security, a theory of just securitization. And her third monograph entitled The Duty to Secure from Just to Mandatory Securitization is forthcoming with Cambridge University Press as well later this year. So we are very much looking forward to the comments of our three discussants. But first of all, I shall hand over to the two authors of the book, which is entitled Israel, National Security and Securitization, The Role of the United States in Defining What Counts, which has just been published by Springer. So Ori and Christian, you have the floor.
Christian, you start, yes.
Thank you. I was trying to unmute myself, but as I'm also sharing my screen, that wasn't so easy to hit the right button. So I've passed the first test and I hope that you can hear me. So that's all good. If after 20 minutes, you're still just nodding and you haven't actually heard a word I was saying, you say something. So I'm absolutely delighted to have you all here. I think it's a great opportunity for us to present the book. And I'm really delighted to have such a distinguished panel of experts discussing obviously the book, but also larger issues in securitization more generally. I'm sure they have a lot of interesting ideas how to take forward this agenda. So we're delighted to have you all here. And we also delighted to have you, the audience here, so that we can have a good discussion about the research, about securitization more generally, about Israel, about the role of external actors. So I think I'm looking forward to that. So let me see if I manage to go forward as well. Okay, so that's the first thing that doesn't seem to work. That is the button to actually push forward the slides. Okay, let me just stop sharing for a second, because maybe then it'll be easier. No, I can't share. Ori, do you want to see if you can? It's just, no, it's there. It's just reacting very, very slowly. Ah, okay, I understand now. Mm-hmm. Ori, it's the Israeli order.
Israeli. No, maybe it's the Iranians.
or that, yes, possibly. But I've now managed to understand that I have to go backwards, not forwards. So let me share my screen again. Okay, so you're managing. So this is the book. And if you want to see an original copy, we have a couple of copies that we can also show you in due course. So the aims of the research, in a sense, they were to provide a development of a conceptual framework for the audience components. On a number of occasions, we've said that the audience components in securitization theory is perhaps not as clear as it could be. The security theory, obviously securitization theory, I will explain in more detail, but here the ambition was that we wanted to find out who the audience is that is needed in order to securitize a certain issue as a security threat. The theoretical integration here is between security studies as a discipline, of course, securitization theory and political psychology on perception and misperception, and also on examining the conceptual framework for four case studies in which Israel faced a particular security threat. Security, as you are very well aware, but for the audience, I thought it might be good to point that out, is an essentially contested concept, or at least for those of you in the audience who agree with that statement. Because of course, defining it a little bit like other essentially contested concepts is inherently a matter of dispute, because of course, no neutral definition as such is possible. So while others of course disagree with that, we would say it is an essentially contested concept. Here, relating it back to the beginnings of the debate in terms of the emergence of a new security order, we can rediscuss that obviously in the light of the latest statements about the Zeitenwende and the kind of re-establishment potentially of a new security order in Europe. But of course, the emergence of a new security order at the end of the Cold War and the discontent of some scholars with what were perceived to be perhaps slightly faulty neorealist foundations within the discipline of strategic and security studies. Also, attempts to make the discipline, of course, more relevant to contemporary concerns and perhaps also practical applications of security theories. The famous two trends, of course, here, firstly, the broadening of the security agenda, the inclusion of new security threats and issues from economic and environmental issues, migration, transnational crime, diseases, human rights, et cetera, and the deepening of the security agenda, the inclusion of new referent objects of security from individual human beings, society, regions, et cetera. So all of this fits in. Why? Well, there's a conviction, obviously, a conviction that we share, that neorealist focus of security of the state in relation to external military threats isn't adequate as the primary or, in fact, the sole focus of our analysis. So, in a sense, we are disputing the claims that were made that taking this study away from this focus would make the discipline intellectually incoherent and practically irrelevant. Actually, what we've seen is that this has spread in all corners of the discipline, and just recently published an article on critical intelligence studies. So I think there's a lot more work that needs to be done in order to bring this new security thinking much further. Foundation here, well, of course, no objective world exists that is distinct from our collective construction by the actors. So therefore, there's no objective knowledge of the world of international politics. We would also underline the importance of interpretive methods of research and a contextual understanding of world politics rather than a generalization of theories as such only. Now, I'll hand over to Ori now when it comes to the book and the securitization aspect. So are you ready? Do you want me to continue the slides? We can't hear you. I think you're still mute.
Can you hear me now? Great.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Christian. I will continue with this book launch. So as Christian said, I don't want to delve too much into securitization theory because I guess most of our audience familiar with this theory. Regarding the first paragraph, securitization is a speech act. I know there is a debate whether it's speech act or practices. I prefer to leave it to a different or another discussion. But basically, we have three arguments, which are practically the basis why we want to suggest a new audience conceptualization. The first one, of course, is the securitization as a speech act. I can give an example that Kristen and I go back in time 10,000 years ago, and we come to an island, and in the island there is inhabitants, and they come to us with their sticks. Of course, there are no weapons back then, and I carry a gun, and I point a gun to them. But they don't understand what is that gun. But for their luck, they don't understand that they're being threatened. But they were lucky that Christian, I speak 2.5 languages, but Christian speaks, I think, 6 or 7. So let's say that he speaks also their language, and he is being the securitizing actor in that process. And he tells them, listen, of course, in their language, not in English, he says, this gun is a threat, is a security threat for you. You must do something against Ori if you want to survive. And this is purely a securitization process with speech act. And this is one point. The second point is that threat is a subjective term. For instance, we saw it perfectly in the COVID-19 pandemic. While in Israel and the UK and other countries, most of the countries in the world, the COVID-19 was perceived as a security threat. While in other countries, for instance, Belarus, the COVID-19 was not defined as a security threat at all. I remember that in Israel, since there was no football aired in the TV, the Belarus Football League was the best in the world because it was one of the only football league that was broadcast. And the third point is that securitization process occurs in all security dimension. I know that some scholars argue that securitization process, it's all about issues that are not connected to the military aspect. But we argue that it is well also the military, the societal, the political, economical, environmental. And when we want to develop a new audience conceptualization that has the ability also to identify what kind of audience are necessary in order to securitize. Again, this conceptualization is not perfect, but we're sure that it can assist scholars to identify those audiences. We need to think about two basic assumptions before we develop this new conceptualization. The first one is that it is necessary to understand what the sources of legitimacy of the audience types are. What actually the legitimacy that the audience provides to the securitizing actor? And the second thing is that it must be taken into consideration different countries have different regimes, norms, laws, and in here, we're actually moving beyond the democratic or Westphalian straitjacket. And after thinking a lot, we understood that we suggested the model that eventually we identified two sources of legitimacy. The first one is the state rules, and the second one is the political perception. We borrow it from Jervis' perception and misperception theory. And this is the political perception of the securitizing actor and or the audience, and I will further explain. So based on those two sources, we have two audiences. The first one is the legal audience, which is an entity which, according to the state rules, has the legal authority to execute the relevant securitization act. And without this audience support, the securitizing actor doesn't have the legal ability and legitimacy to conduct that relevant securitization act. I will give an example. In order to execute the Oslo Accord, Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin, who was the securitizing actor, he needed the support of the Israeli government. The Israeli government and in order, which was the legal audience, in order to securitize the threat of the binational state. I will speak further about the Oslo peace process in the next couple of minutes, but I will move to the second type of the audience, which is the political audience, okay? The political audience is an entity that it supports or lack of resistance, while in the legal audience, it's yes or no. The political audience, if it supports, it's great. We have a securitization. But if it's not resist to the securitization, this is also actually a support. So political audience is an entity that it supports or lack of resistance for securitization. It's both not required according to the state rules and is perceived by the securitizing actor and or audience as an essential condition for successfully performing a securitization act. And without a political audience support, again, or its lack of resistance, the securitizing actor and or audience thinks that there is not sufficient legitimacy to conduct securitization. I will give two examples. If the audience can mute themselves, it will be helpful. Thank you so much. The first example is when the securitizing actor, we're talking about the securitizing actor perception. Then I think, can you please then mute you? Thank you so much. The first example is when the securitizing actor's perception is important in this case. And the Bush administration, prior to the destruction of the Syrian nuclear reactor in 2007, was perceived by Prime Minister Ehud Olmert as an essential in order to securitize. Olmert believed, while he had the Israeli government support, which was the legal audience, he believed that it's not enough. He believed that he needs also to obtain the support, or at least the lack of resistance of the Americans back then in order to securitize the Syrian nuclear reactor. Again, he was able to securitize that nuclear reactor only with the support of the Israeli government. But no, his political perception and understanding made him believe that he needs the American support. The second type is when the audience perception is important here. And this example comes from the Six-Day War in 1967. Again, there were actually two parallel dimensions in that securitization process. The first one was between the IDF, which was the securitizing actor back then, and they needed to obtain the support of the Israeli government in order to launch a preemptive strike against Egypt. But again, also here, the Israeli government believed that they need the support, or at least the lack of resistance, of the Johnson administration back then in 1967 in order to preempt against the Egyptians. In the book, and this is further elaborated there, we used four case studies that we think that are really adequate in order to explain how issues are being securitized in the Israeli room, and also what is the role of the United States in that process. The first one was the Oslo Accords, which the unique thing is that a peace agreement between Israel and the PLO were used as their extraordinary measures to securitize the binational state threat. For Israel, for Yitzhak Rabin, who was the prime minister back then in 1993, he believed that Israel is under danger of the binational state threat. And in order to securitize that danger, that threat, he suggested to conduct the Oslo Accords in order to create a political separation between Israel and the Palestinian living in the Gaza Strip and the West Bank. And here, as I said, the unique thing is that while most of the people think that they need the extraordinary measures are mostly attacking wars and etc., here we see that the peace process, a peace agreement, this is the tool, the extraordinary measures in order to securitize a security threat or even an existential threat. The second case study was the Syrian nuclear reactor in 2007 when Israel demolished that nuclear reactor back then. And we compare between two cases which are totally similar, but with different actors. In 1981, Israel demolished the Iraqi nuclear facility, nuclear reactor. But back then, Prime Minister Menachem Begin, while of course he obtained the Israeli cabinet approval for securitization, he didn't perceive the American support or even lack of resistance as necessary or essential in order to securitize that existential threat. On the contrary, Ehud Olmert, who was the prime minister in 2007, he believed, as I spoke about this before, he believed that he needs the American support, or again, the lack of resistance. The third case study was the Six-Day War in 1967. And here we find a very interesting term, which is that support can be both, on the one hand, it can be objective, and on the one hand, it can be subjective. And I will explain. While the IDF obtained the support of the securitize from the Israeli government, and this is actually an objective support because the government said, okay, we agree, and we cannot this is an objective thing, okay? And on the other hand, the Israeli government believed that it obtained support to securitize from the Americans, because it wasn't clear whether the Americans, we still have debate more than 50 years until today, whether the Americans supported Israel to preempt the strike against Egypt. But in our case, in our securitization case, what is very interesting here is that the Israeli believed that it obtained the support to securitize from the Americans, and we call it a subjective support. The fourth case study in the last is Protective Shield in 2002. After the beginning of the second Palestinian Intifada, when the Palestinian conducted the very severe terrorist attack in Israel, inside the Israeli cities against civilians, Prime Minister Sharon, he wanted to securitize the PLO and Yasser Arafat. And in order to do it, he of course needed the support of the Israeli government in order to launch attack against the Palestinian Authority. But he also needed, same like Olmert, he believed that he must obtain the American support for this act. But here, again, Sharon, like in 1967, Sharon believed that he obtained the Bush administration support, which here again, we're talking about the subjective support. So in brief, four insights that we believe that we contribute, this book contributes to our understanding on securitization theory. The first thing is that threat is a subjective term. The second thing is that peace agreements, and not only military measures, are also used as extraordinary measures for securitization. The third insight is that we see the complexity of the audience component, the legal versus the political aspect of the audience component. And the fourth is the objective versus the subjective support, as you can see in both case studies in 1967 and 2002. And I wish to conclude with a remark, and we took it a bit from Bill Clinton's political campaign to president in the US president elections in 1992. He said, it's the economy stupid, but what we want to deliver is that it is not only sufficient to find out whether the audience granted its support for securitization or not, it is also a necessary condition
because to explore. Which is that now,
it is also a necessary condition to explore how the securitizing actor itself interpreted the audience reply. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christian and Ori. And I will now hand over to Professor Kobi Michael for his comments and thoughts on the book or on securitization more broadly. You have the floor.
You're on mute. Kobi, you're on mute.
Yes. Okay. So first of all, I would like to congratulate Christian and Ori for their book. And I think that this book provides a significant contribution to the theoretical infrastructure and the conceptual infrastructure of securitization as such. I think that the theoretical development with regard to the audiences by distinguishing between the legal audience and the political audience, it is an important theoretical development that has also, or can be also, as an infrastructure for developing some tools for designing policy, decision making, and influence. And I think that in this regard, it is a sort of a very important contribution, because it is not only a theoretical contribution, but also practical contribution, or at least it can be translated to practical contribution. And without mentioning, I think that, that the authors identified also another important phenomenon that unfortunately that they haven't developed or elaborated much about it. And this is the idea of the dual role of the specific audiences. In specific context, and at least from reading the book and the analysis of the case studies, we can understand that a legal audience can become a political audience, or in some other occasions, a legal audience can be a political audience in the very same time. I think that the example of the Israeli government with regard to the Oslo process is such an example, where the government is first of all a legal actor, but in the very same time it is also a political actor. And here I think that there is another important observation that was made, although was not elaborated enough. I think that the case studies, the four case studies about Israel, lay a very historical, factual, empiric infrastructure, very comprehensive one, that frames, I would say, in a narrative manner, the events along the time axis. And this is an important source of knowledge in this regard. I think that the book is one of the most comprehensive, I would say, books or researches about the idea of securitization in the Israeli context. And I assume that it will become to be a research infrastructure for the future, maybe because of the objection that some researchers, like me, for an example, will have with regard to some of the definitions and some of the conceptualizations that were made in the book. But anyway, it will be a very important contribution for further research and the theoretical discussion, and not only among scholars. I think that the most significant contribution of the book is the analysis of the Oslo process, because when the authors decided to bring this case as a case study, they actually, at least as far as I know and as far as I'm familiar with the materials regarding securitization, this is the first time that a political process, a peace process, is introduced as an extraordinary measure, which was used by the political echelon in Israel in this case, and I think that in this regard this is a very important contribution, because as Ori said in his presentation, usually in the literature regarding securitization, when we are talking about extraordinary measures or extreme measures, we are talking about using violence or using force. The idea of limiting freedom, just for an example, all the idea of COVID-19, okay, or denying rights, and here in the case of Oslo, this is a different example. I have a principal dispute or disagreement with Ori, and I assume that with Christian as well, although I didn't speak with Christian about it, with regard to the expansion of the concept of securitization to military and security threats. Because as far as I understand the securitization and the importance of the concept of securitization is the idea of the transformation, the idea of transforming civilian issues and reframing them as security threats. even as an existential threat because of the severe security essence. And therefore, I think that when we expand the concept of security and we try to analyze with by using this concept, we try to analyze cases where the essence, the basic essence of the threat was security or militarily, I think that actually this is a sort of redundancy of the concept, and the concept is losing its analytical power. I think that that there is a sort of logic failure in conceptualizing by using the securitization concept, conceptualizing security threat as security threat or as existential threat, when they are basically are considered as such. We can talk about glorifying or maybe exaggerating the range of the security threat or their essence, but we are not making here the transformation process of civilian issues or civilian challenges and reframing them as security issues, because in their essence there are security issues. And therefore I think that three of the four case studies that were chosen for Israel, the Second Intifada, the Six-Day War, and the Syrian nuclear facility, they are not case studies which are fit to the analysis by using the concept of securitization. Because basically all of these three events were perceived from the first beginning as very dangerous and even existential in the eyes of the political echelon and the military echelon. In the three cases, in the three mentioned cases, there was no argue about the need to address these threats, even by using some extraordinary measures. The dispute or the argument was about the timing and about the methodology, about the way how to use the extreme measures or the extraordinary measures. In the case of Six-Day War, the argument was about the idea of first of all, making all the political efforts vis-a-vis the Americans and to get their support for the military attack, which was preemptive attack, but there was no any argument between the political echelon and the military echelon about the need to tackle this threat, and it was clearly understood that eventually it's going to be tackled militarily. Okay, the argument was about the timing and about the need to have the American support before the preemptive attack. With regard to the Second Intifada, I think that this is an example for just an opposite case of securitization, because the Intifada began in September 2000. The operation Defensive Shield began in March 22. Okay, and Sharon was actually pressured by the politician, by the military, by the Israeli public to retaliate aggressively against the Palestinians. And he refused to retaliate because he understood that he has to charge the legitimacy battery mainly vis-a-vis the international community in order to retaliate militarily against the Palestinians. And therefore, I think that here Sharon was not needed to securitize the situation, because it was already pretty securitized, and I think that this is not the case, or at least not the ultimate case of securitization. Now, some general comments with your permission. I think that the book maybe should have been written a bit differently, because the general feeling of the reader is that we have here, some articles that were brought together, and therefore I recognize in some places repetitions, and some arguments were repeated at least four or five times in the different chapters. And I assume that it was because each chapter was written by itself as an article or something like that. I think that it should have been reconsidered in this regard. I think that also there is a sort of imbalance between the analytical sections of the book and the narrative sections of the book. And the imbalance is for the narrative section, which is very well developed. And I think that it's too developed in some places even, because it's overloading or overloaded with historical details. And I think that this is something that makes the reading of the book a bit heavy for the reader. And the general sense is that we have here a very detailed description of many, many trees, but the general picture of the entire forest remain a bit blurred. And I will conclude, with your permission, with some very specific comments. First of all, there is a paragraph, I think that it is in the conclusion chapter of the book, that says that this book may shed light on how the state of Israel deals with existential security threats. And I think that the threats that the authors meant to are not necessarily threats that were dealt by using securitization. Some of them were used by using some other tools. Another comment that I had is with regard to very broad generalization, I think, with regard to the European actor, when you say in the book, and I quote, therefore, the EU has not performed the role of the political audience during the securitization process in Israel. I think that it is too general, and it's not necessarily true in all the cases, mainly not with regard to the Iranian issue, and with regard to the Palestinian incitement and all the idea of BDS. I think that in these cases the Europeans are playing a more significant role that in comparison to the description in the book. Now, with regard to the methodology, you wrote in the chapter that you used personal interviews as a very essential element, and it is a very important element and a very important tool, but in the very same time, we have to be very cautious. And I'm saying it mainly with regard to Ehud Olmert. Why? Because people, mainly political leaders, military commanders who are interviewed a decade or two decades after an event that they were deeply involved in, they have the tendency to remember differently the events, okay? And as I said, I remember it very clearly with regard to Ehud Olmert, who changed his perception with regard to the Annapolis process. I heard him personally in the 2010, when he said that Abu Mazen eventually refused to his proposal. And I read his book in 2015 or 16, when he said that Abu Mazen didn't say no, okay? So it depends in the place you see it, okay? And therefore we have to be a bit cautious with regard to the authenticity of personal interviews. And the last thing that I would like to say is your comment that Barak perceived Arafat and the Palestinian Authority as partners for peace with Israel. And this sentence is written or follows a sentence about Sharon approach that was in the opposite side, of course. And here I have to say that this is not a fair comparison because the context is very different, okay? And I assume that if Barak was in the same context, in the same years of Sharon, he would have perceived Arafat and the Palestinian Authority in a very similar way that Sharon perceived it. So to make a comparison between two different persons and their perception with regard to the same objective, but in very different times and very different contexts, I think that this is something which is a bit problematic. I will conclude by saying that, as I said in the beginning, I think that it is a very important book with a very significant contribution to the literature of securitization, generally speaking, and securitization in Israel specifically. And I think that this book actually lays the infrastructure for further discussion, further research, and further disagreements between scholars and practitioners. And congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Michael. So certainly a lot of food for thought here, and I'm sure Christian and Ori may want to engage with those later, but let's hear now from our second discussant, Professor Balzac.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me well? I hope so. If something goes wrong, just, you know, Christian, because I can see you on the screen, just wave your hand. Well, I think the book, Israel, National Security and Securitization, right? The title is really Israel, right? That's, and then you have a semicolon, then you have National Security and Securitization, and then you have another subtitle, right? It's a very exciting book from my point of view. It focuses on the question of audience. It sets out to address one of those issues that I think have been really churning securitization scholars for a while. The book has many strengths, but I want to just maybe highlight two. The first one is that the book offers really an uncompromising discussions of securitization theory's main components. It's not only about audience, it actually goes a little bit beyond audience. The second value of the book is that it cuts across a wealth of empirical data to probe its premises, decompose and compare different cases involving mainly one national context. And what I also like from the book is that it ends with what are the take-home things, right? The insights, something that is often very, very difficult to do when you address such a large spectrum of cases. And across such a long, large time span as well. Now, what a good book does, I would say, is that it prompts further thinking, right? That's a mark of a good book. So I would like to bring a set of the ideas for discussion here. These are just really ideas for conversation. The first one is really the spine of the book, right? The spine of the book is a hard case. Audience is really something that has really haunted scholars. In securitization studies. A number of questions have preoccupied students. Christian, yourself, and Sarah have tried to deal with this, so you know how complicated the issue is already. What it is, that's one of the questions that people have asked. How does it stand vis-a-vis other actors in the securitization process? How many are there when we do securitization? Which one matters? How does it contribute to the emergence of a threat? And if it is involved in a threat construction, is it responsible for things that go wrong? All these things are really important issues when it comes to securitization. Now, the book's orienting research line is to identify the sources of the legitimacy of the audience. And that's the line where you try to differentiate them. And I think this is an intriguing way of angle. Because I would say heretofore, we have tended to emphasize the legitimacy of the securitizing actors. That's what we have been doing. Or trying to see whether the practices that ensue from a securitizing move that has been successful, whether those practices are legitimate, right? That's what we've been doing in the in securitization. So your demarcation then between these two different different kinds of audiences, the political one and the legal one, drawing on the legitimacy of these audiences is something that I think was a good move. Now, I'm not saying that I agree with the move, right? But I have to praise you for the move. Now, the first point I want to, in terms of trying to raise a discussion, the first one is that legitimacy is a very technical question. It's a very technical term. And I was really somehow expecting that you would probably discuss more in terms of the components of legitimacy and see how they apply and these things. And one of them, we know that legitimacy, at least, there is still discussion, but there is a great agreement that legitimacy has three interrelated components. The one of them is legality. The second one is justification, and the third one is consent, right? These three things are often called upon when we talk about legitimacy. So which means that even when a process is legal, it has to be justified. And there is some consent that is involved as well, right? I think that touches on the question of Kobi Michael when he was talking about the fact that some of these audiences, your political one sometimes is also a legal one, right? The move is very difficult to just draw a wedge between the two. Now, the most important thing is that the legitimacy actually has this role of reducing the room for resistance, right? Because when it becomes legitimate, then the room for resistance is reduced. Now, my understanding of the way you were proceeding is that it seems like the political audience that you brought forward has to be first politicized to exist, right? It is as if there is a claim that is made by a securitizing actor, and then there is some kind of the political audience is something that is maybe in the head of the securitizing actor, the targeted one, and they try to speak to them. In that sense, I was asking myself the extent to which that audience is not already given in the head of the person securitizing, because it seems like, in your view, when it comes to the US at least, when the process starts, we know what it is. And I was wondering whether the strength of your argument is not somewhere else, which is that probably if you want to retain the concept of political audience, it becomes even stronger if we accept that it is not pre-given, in the sense that it is by raising a claim that a certain audience emerges. That's something that I was thinking maybe probably in your, that's something that your book actually is heading towards. And if we accept that, then maybe the difference between the political, the legal, the formal, moral distinctions is not that strong. Maybe it's not where you see it. In the sense that it might be that your argument, it's not really about distinguishing them, but it's about asking yourself, how does a moral audience get constituted and what moral audience actually arises? And that's something that I think that's where you bring something. Because so far, we have the formal moral, but we didn't know how the moral audience, which moral audience matters, and how does the securitizing actor decide to focus on one of them. And this is what your book is doing very well. And I think this is probably where you dug a little bit further than what we really have on securitization. And it's a lot, right? In these days, when you find this kind of originality, you have to be very happy. Now, one of the things, and I'm saying this because from my point of view, what really matters is fundamentally, and we don't disagree on this, right? Fundamentally, what matters when it comes to audiences, it is whether the audience actually, either the audience brings acceptance is a necessary or a sufficient or both to make a security issue comes to life, right? In certain places, you were making that distinction, saying, well, this is necessary, But then you were not adding whether it was sufficient. You left that to the, but we could see that there is actually, this is exactly what you were trying to do with the with this distinction, is trying to see what audience actually makes a difference, whether it is necessary, sufficient, or both, right? I found a comparison on the Beijing armored attitude toward the US, which also has been discussed, an intriguing one. But I was also wondering the extent to which at times when you speak about the US, we're not bordering what some people would call overlay, because you have an external actor in the game, and that the presence of that external actor changes the securitizing game, right? Because the US is in the region, because the US is such an important actor in the evolution of Israel's life, maybe we have reached historically a position where the US can no longer be ignored, right? So I was asking myself, things that were probably possible, do you think maybe in years to come that would still be feasible, where they would, Israel would maybe do something without asking the US? I'm not very sure, right? I'm not in the system, but I would guess that his story has something to do about the shift in attitude, right? It might also be that in selecting to speak to the, or to involve Israel, the US in the game, it might also have something to do with the personal relationship between the leaders in office, right? In that sense, your political audience arises when there is an affinity, right? And that then raises a question of persuasion, because if there is already that kind of very strong alignment between views, where is the persuasion part in the securitization process? The other thing I was asking myself, this is a very, very broad one, and I would end up there, is really, I was asking myself, because you start the book with this thing saying that we're living in a routine state of emergency. It's really like securitization has no ceiling, right? Securitization unbound. And I was asking myself, this is really, while doing the research with Ori, how did you cope with that, right? How did you deal with this issue that you operating, you're doing research in a context that is already saturated with security discourse practices in a very high level, right? So how did you play with that degree of securitization in that particular context? Because I found that that's a really huge challenge to grapple with. And this is really trying to have your experience in working in that very specific context. That being said, thank you for the book. Very, very well written. Even if there are four hands, repetition, yes, but well written. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Thierry. And now on to Dr. Rita Floyd.
Yes, hello, thank you. Can you hear me okay? Yeah, okay, good. Well, thank you for having me. I obviously saw in the lineup that I would be coming after Thierry, and I was quite worried, what else can I say once he has spoken about securitization? And the easy solution to that, obviously, is to bring my own work to this book and to see how would I interpret what I see in front of me. And so that's essentially what I want to do. So I think what I will, or the essence of my talk will be to suggest that what you identify as political and legal audiences are not really audiences at all, but rather they are functional actors in securitization processes. So what I want to say is that by and large, I agree with what you put, you know, the role and the categories, there's some really clever stuff in there, but I would use different labels. And of course, you know, we're all steeped in our own research. We can't get away from that, you know, and I'm even mentioned in the book as the one person who disregards the audience. And I do by label, but not necessarily the idea in the way that you have it. So let me try and explain that. I'm going to have to look at these notes here quite a lot. I should have done a PowerPoint, but I didn't. So the first point I want to make, when you talk about legal audiences, and that obviously seems to be, if there was such a thing as a legal audience, that would be quite a significant challenge to my own claim that audiences don't really matter or don't really exist, right? Because if you were right on this one, then it seems to me I would be wrong. But so what would I put on this? It seems to me that what you identify as legal audience, and some of the cases, you know, where you have essentially the executive and then parliament, if you like, if this was the British context, to me, this is kind of intra-elite. So this is the elite actor that you split into different factions. But most of the time, actually, parliament, I would think, in emergencies, would actually already be on board with the executive and the elite actor, as we've seen and has been reported, you know, quite extensively in the context of 9/11 in the United States, where essentially nobody objected. But the other thing to me is that you want to move away from a Western-centric context. I can't remember actually whether this was in this book or in the presentation at ISA, but it seems to me, certainly Christian, that you probably have a wider interest in moving away from the Western straitjacket. But it seems to me that this move with the legal audience makes it very much about democracies and a particular type of democracy. So that seems a sort of move that is actually maybe counterproductive. And then the other thing, of course, is that in emergencies, the legal audience is not necessarily always consulted. You know, sometimes the executive just rules by decree or makes decisions that, you know, that suspends the ordinary legal processes. So if at least some of this is correct, it seems to me, and this is essentially the claim that I've made all along, is that we can't have the audience as a categorical, analytical category as part of securitization. Sometimes there is this kind of legal audience that you identify as, and it is relevant, but often it isn't. Or sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. And as long as it is not always the case, you can't really include it into the theory. So that would be my first point. Then I want to come to the political audience. So on page 26, this is in the context of the Six-Day War, you write about the Israeli government that is in sort of one and the same securitization, the audience, but also later the securitizing actor. And I have no problem with that at all. I think I agree, you know, that the same kind of actor can occupy a different role in securitization at time X and at time Y, if you like. You call that positional duality in securitization processes, which is a good phrase. I've already cited it somewhere. But what I would suggest here, I don't think that that when the IDF, which is the Israeli Defense Force, securitizes or tries to securitize the issue, you say now the government is the legal audience. I would say in this instance, the government operates as a functional actor, an actor that, you know, plays a significant role in the sector, that can endorse or object to securitization on behalf of others, but that is not a securitizing actor or the referent object. I'll say a little bit more about this in a minute. Then in this same scenario, you also argue that the government steps up and performs rhetorical securitization and that the United States government are now the audience, so the political audience, right? And then you then actually show that the US did not give their consent, but that somehow the securitizing actor misunderstood and started the war anyway. So to me, that example obviously seems to be, well, I would latch onto that and say, doesn't this case prove that audience consent doesn't matter? You know, it can go ahead regardless of consent. I mean, you interpret it differently. You say essentially that they thought there was consent and therefore they went ahead. But You could also say there wasn't consent and they did it anyway. But then I was also questioning, well, why is it that you think the United States is the audience? Was the Speech Act leveled against them? You know, are they the ones that are being protected? No. Are they the ones that are being warned off to say, you know, stop what you're doing? No. So in a sense, then, to me, in my interpretation, they are not audiences in the true meaning of the word. But I think at the same time that you are correct to say they do hold, play an important part, that they do play a role in this because they are so powerful. And especially, you know, as Thierry was saying, in the minds of the Israeli government at the time, somehow this actor seems to matter. And it seems to me, you know, they would like to have consent from the US because somehow it would give greater legitimacy to what they are about to do. So again, it seems to me here that the US also is a functional actor in this, you know, and there are different categories of functional actor. This is a sort of what I call somewhere a legitimator. So they play the role of legitimator, but not, you know, in a sense of a justification of coercive power, but rather a sort of moral legitimacy. You know, if the US say we can do this, then we are actually permitted to do this. So in a word, then, I think what you identify as political and legal audiences are really different kinds of functional actors, actors who endorse or reject securitization on behalf of others. And I think that, you know, quite a bit more work should be done on this whole notion of functional actor, and actually very much in line with what Thierry just said, in terms of why do certain functional actors matter in certain circumstances? Why are certain actors, even quite obscure actors, powerful in certain situations and so on? So I think that is quite a good way for securitization theory to move forward, or securitization studies. And I think that you, with this, you know, provide some of the evidence or some of the examples how it could be done, albeit with a different label. I just wanted to make one other point before, two, in fact, if you allow me. I had some issue with the Oslo Accords as a case of securitization, because to me that is a case of desecuritization. Because it's about peace. It's not, you know, it's deliberately about moving away from the threat and defense logic. So to me, that was possibly, I mean, you could have done it as desecuritization and then looked at, well, do we need audiences or functional actors in desecuritization as well? That kind of thing. And then my very last comment is on the objectiveness of threats, which is, Ori, in your presentation, you said, the islanders don't understand that they are threatened when I come onto their island with a gun. But isn't that actually a proof that objective threats exist? Because you are objectively threatening to them, even though they haven't a clue that you are threatening them. So to me, objective threats exist. But security threats are socially constructed.
Thank you very much, Rita, and thank you very much to all three discussants. I think so much material for Christian and Ori for the next book, but perhaps there are just a couple of key points that they want to react to straight away, and then but not to everything, please, because I'm also very mindful of the time. So just perhaps pick a couple of points that you think are really important and that you want to speak to right now, and then we will open to questions and comments from the audience. So Ori and Christian, over to you.
Yeah.
So I start, Christian. You start. Okay.
I can start. I mean, initially I thought I'm going to write all this down, and then I will have time to provide comments. But now my notes are 2 pages, and I no longer know all the things that I want to talk about. So I'll just stick with 1 or 2 points, and just to firstly thank you for all the comments. I think they're fantastic comments, and I think they'll be very, very useful also to make further articles, to potentially develop further books. I think that is definitely very, very valuable. So thank you all for making all those comments. I think I wanted to mention something to Kobi, because you said that you might disagree with Ori, but you didn't have the chance to discuss it with me yet. So I thought I'll give you that chance just to kind of mention something there. I think you're right in the sense that in the book, initially, when you just look at it from the outset, it looks like there's a number of different military challenges that, as you put, like, in a sense, we know that there's security that are being, or at least it looks like that's what is being analyzed. But I think when you go into the case studies much more deeply, actually the security threat as such is, I think it is debatable whether we always know about or at least there's a longer process of securitization, shall we put it like that? I mean, if we, like you mentioned, obviously the Iranian nuclear bomb is clearly perceived as a security threat. So in the Israeli security echelon, I have no doubt that there's agreement on that question. But of course, as a matter of principle, if we look at the international community more generally, there isn't necessarily that same level of agreement. And if we look at nuclear weapons more generally, I mean, they're very simple. It's a relational issue at the end of the day, isn't it? It's a relational issue that, for instance, the British government might perceive the Iranian nuclear bomb as a security threat, but it wouldn't perceive the American nuclear bomb as a security threat. There's a very clear reason for that. It's because it's a relational issue that obviously the American bomb is not perceived to be threatening the United Kingdom, whereas the Iranian bomb is. So in that sense, I think there's that issue. So obviously within the security echelon, let's say, in Israel, there's agreement now that indeed the Iranian bomb is threatening Israel. So in that sense, you don't have to repeat the same arguments over and over. But of course, if you go back a couple of years, then there wouldn't have necessarily been that consensus in the same way. So for instance, if we are to think, let's say, the Shah was already making some moves towards building a bomb, perhaps in the Israeli security establishment at the time, they wouldn't have perceived that necessarily as a security threat, even though it's objectively the same country with a different leadership, granted. But at the time, they perhaps wouldn't have seen that as a security threat so much, even though objectively, they could potentially do the same kind of damage. And I think the same issue can be looked at in the other kind of case studies. If we're looking at the Egyptian army, for instance, if we're looking at the context today, right, that isn't necessarily perceived as a security threat. And I'm keeping it a little bit vague because I don't want to open a can of worms. But obviously, the perception of that as a security actor has also changed over time. And in that sense, even though issues may appear military, may appear as an objective security threat, but over time, of course, that issue is relational, it's situational, it's historical. So all of these kind of variables, they kind of change what is perceived as a security threat or not. I'll hand over to Thierry because I'm needing to cough. So
Ori, probably.
Sorry, I meant Ori. I was just so focused on my cough.
Thank you, Christian. Okay, can you hear me? Yes. Okay. First, a personal note. I guess all of you know that when a PhD student or even a BA or MA student and he wants to delve into securitization theory, he reads first. The first reading is, the book that Buzan, Weber, and De Wilde wrote, but the essential reading is the articles of the very important people that are here. And the first articles that I read as a PhD student was Professor Bazak's, Dr. Floyd, and of course, Professor Kaunert and Léonard. And for me, this is a great honor. Again, personally, I never thought 8 years ago when I started my PhD that I'm going to discuss with you about the book Chris and I wrote. So again, thank you for this opportunity. And now I will comment briefly, okay? First of all, by order, to Kobi. You're right, the duality aspect is very, as you said, significant. And the article is under construction, let's say. We are writing this article, it's in work. And this is one thing. Christian has already spoke about our disagreement regarding the military aspect of securitization. I will not comment on that. I will never convince you, I know, but the life are more interesting when we disagree than we agree on everything. You're absolutely right regarding the interviews. For this book, we conducted lots of elite interviews with prime ministers, defense ministers, etc. And one, I don't want to give his name, but a very notable person told me that sometimes later they have their own selective memory, and you're totally right. So when we interviewed Olmert, we needed also to interview Ehud Barak. So now we're even, you know, if you interviewed both Olmert or Barak, we have both narratives, so we are fine. Regarding the United States and Europe, I think that we agree on most of the things, but you know, the reality shows us that eventually, even though the EU has their own opinion regarding the security aspect of Israel, peace process, the Palestinians, eventually, in reality, only the United States can impact Israel in some way, and therefore the Americans are the political audience in this matter. Now I will go forward to Professor Balzac's comment. As you said, one of the aims was in our book is to connect between securitizing, between securitization theory and of course IR to political psychology. I know that there is a trend to connect between two fields, and this was our aim. And we took, as I mentioned, we took, and it's also mentioned in the book, we took Jervis' theory regarding a perception and misperception, but I want to a bit elaborate on that matter. I remember that when I worked with President Herzog, when he ran to, when he was a politician and he ran to the Labour Party leadership, I remember that he needed the support of some activists, that he had a member of the party, in the Labour Party, that he had, he wasn't that strong in the party, but everyone believed that he is almighty. So what I'm trying to say is that it doesn't matter, again, it's all about perception. The reality, and maybe he's he has lots of voters, but eventually it's what people think about that person. And the same goes regarding between between states and securitization process. And eventually the political audience, as we mentioned, is mainly based on the political and political understanding and perception of the audience as the securitizing actor, and basically politicians' political understanding, as we mentioned, while Prime Minister Begin believed he doesn't need the American support, Olmert thought otherwise. And why we use that case study, because it's almost the same threat, the same players, okay, actors, but not the same individuals. Regarding the state of emergency, I understood that state of emergency, again, it's a very relative term. Like it's true that Israel, one can argue that we are in a state of emergency all the time because we are surrounded by enemies. But again, you know, people, the civilian life here are, and I'm living in the UK, so I know, and I also live in Germany and live in Israel, it's the same. But again, state of emergency is something very relative. And maybe, you know, discussing and exploring about the Israeli case studies, securitization, I think that in some aspects, they are quite similar to other European countries, for instance. Dr. Floyd, I have several comments, but the first comment, if our argument is about labels, Kristen and I did our job, and I'm not going to quit now, but listen, this is superb to hear this from you. If you only disagree on labels, I think we did a great job. Regarding the Six-Day War, what is written in the book, it's actually quite accurate regarding, and we also express this in the book regarding the duality. The government, it had two roles. The first dimension, the government was the legal audience in front of the IDF. And in the second dimension, the same government, it was the securitizing actor in front of the Americans. Okay, so maybe maybe there is a bit of a misunderstanding, but this is the complexity of the audience component as we try to explain in the book. And eventually the support matters, because if the Israeli government, they weren't believed that the Americans, they're not resisting an Israeli preempt, one can argue that Israel will never launch a preemptive strike against Egypt. But again, this is what happened. We can predict what would have happened if something else would have happened. Last thing regarding the Oslo peace process. The true fact, and you know, it's based on argument, and unfortunately Rabin was murdered before we thought writing this book many years ago. Our interpretation is that, and again, it's based off interviews with people who worked with him. Okay, unfortunately Rabin didn't have chance to write his memories. He didn't search for peace. The peace process, I know it's a bit hard to say, but it was the pretext. He used the peace process in order to curb the binational state threat, because his great aim was to keep the state of Israel both democratic and both the Jewish state. And in that matter, it was a pure securitization process. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Christian and Ori. And I would like now to open the floor to questions from the audience. So there is a comment already in the chat box, which is in line with what Rita was saying about two processes of securitizing and desecuritization at the same time. So are there any other, so thank you very much for that. Are there other comments or questions? So please feel free to use the chat box. And there is a question that's in the process of coming through about the role of the audience in the securitization process. Carlos, would you like to unmute yourself and ask your question?
Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to say some words about this conference. First of all, to congratulate Professor Kaunert and Ori for this book. I haven't read it yet, but I'm certain that I will do and I will enjoy it. My PhD thesis was also focused on the theory of securitization, and I read a lot from Professor Floyd and, of course, from Professor Balzac. And indeed, on my PhD thesis, I focused on the role of the audience. So I've realized that, in fact, there are two kinds of the audience, the concerning the securitizer actor. And one thing that I didn't understand, perhaps Professor Kaunert or Ori could explain how they deal with that, is the role of the all security agencies, namely, for instance, secret services, military, all of those professionals of security or insecurity, how do they influence policymakers regarding that legitimate or the legal role they have to securitize some issues? That's my question.
Thank you very much. We're going to take a couple of questions as there's not much time left. So there is a question in the box from Johnny. So would the authors agree that securitization theory applied in such cases as Israel always has a normative / orientalist weighting against the non-Western actor when constructing one side as a threat? It seems that internationally, outside of the specific country, Palestine is always discursively constructed as the threat, whilst Israel is the defender, despite the fact that Israel engages in far more problematic action in terms of violence than the Palestinian side. So that is another couple of questions here. Any other questions at this point? If not, then I hand over to back to Christian and Ori.
Do you want to take the question, Ori?
You take the first one, I will take the second one.
Okay. You go first because I still have my issue with my throat.
Okay. Regarding the second question, I don't want to start, all the political dispute here, but eventually in the Israeli eyes, the Palestinian terrorism posed a security threat to the state of Israel. Okay, maybe it's not an existential threat, but it's a security threat. And that's why Israel needed to curb that threat, like it did in the operation in 2002, which we elaborate about this in the book. Regarding the Oslo peace process, I don't know if Johnny here mentioned, it's not written in the question, but again, what we try to show here in the book and also in the Oslo peace process case study is the uniqueness of that extraordinary measures are not necessarily a military element. Okay, sometimes a peace process can be used in order to securitize the threat. And for Israel, the most important thing for Israelis and the government is that the state of Israel will continue to be both a democratic and a Jewish state. Thank you.
Thank you, Ori. So Christian tells me that he was coughing as Carlos asked his question. So Carlos, would you be able to just repeat your question very briefly? Because I think Christian kind of missed part of it.
My question is, if you take to account the role play of all security professionals during the securitization process, namely, for instance, intelligence services, police, the military, that, in my opinion, do contribute to the securitization process, including to those who have the power to do the speech act, so securitizing something. That's the question.
Yeah, I think the answer is relatively clear. I think it's true, of course, that the security professionals are the first line actors, if you like. Not in every case, but in many cases, it's like the actor that is bringing out the warning sign, right? There's a security threat out there. There's whether we going from military security, where there's obviously the military intelligence analyst that is going to give us that information, to even health security, where it's, you know, the WHO kind of giving us an alarm raise that, you know, now we have a pandemic. So in a sense, it is those professionals indeed. It's not exclusively though, because if we look at, let's say, the issue of migration that Sarah and I have been working on a lot, it can be a variety of different actors. So there you can have those actors as well, of course, and you can also have politicians, but especially if you have politicians, it can be, of course, as you perfectly also know, the far right actors that could also be playing that particular role. So it depends a little bit from case to case, but on the whole, I think you're not wrong. I think on the whole, I think there's many cases where, of course, the security professionals, and you can define them in different ways depending on which area you look at, I think they will be in the first line, absolutely.
If I may add to Carlos' question, I totally agree with Christian, and we also illustrate this in the book. For instance, in the Six-Day War, the IDF, they're actually somehow, even though they were the securitizing actor as a whole, there are security professionals. And also in the case study of the Syrian nuclear reactor in 2007, the Mossad, now it's declassified, we can speak about it. The Mossad had, and also Amman, the Israeli intelligence, they had a huge role in identifying and also not just identify the nuclear reactor, but also to label it as a security threat. And again, you're right in your observation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ori. And unfortunately, we are out of time, so we will have to bring this webinar to a conclusion. But first of all, I would like again to congratulate and to thank the two authors, so Christian and Ori, for a great presentation. And certainly, if those of you who haven't bought or read the book yet, I'm sure you're going to do this in the near future. And thank you so much to our three discussants who have provided excellent comments and feedback and given our two authors a lot to think about for the next book, I'm sure. And thank you very much to all the audience members for joining us today and asking questions. So without further ado, I just would like to say goodbye to you now and see you at the next webinar then. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Sorry for joining late.
No worries.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.